I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show. It is a great pleasure to welcome Professor Omar Bartov, Brown University. His new book is Anatomy of a Genocide, The Life and Death of a Town Called Buchach. The book has on the cover a photograph of survivors. This is a story of survival, but at the same time, centuries of criminal behavior, confusion of loyalties, blood feuds. They continue because this village, Buchach, is now part of Ukraine, Western Ukraine, and we all know Ukraine is caught up in a frozen conflict between the remains of the Russian Empire, that is now the Russian Federation, Ukraine, which is a national sovereign state, and the Europeans and Americans competing with the Russians for the attention of Ukraine. Professor, a very good evening to you. Thank you very much for this. Congratulations, especially because I know this is part of the story of your family. You begin your conversations about this town called Buchach with your mother. You were born in Israel, and many Buchachers emigrated to Israel in the 20th century. So I want to begin with the geography of Buchach, because that is critical to understand why the people there have suffered for centuries in the war fighting. Buchach, from your description, is a beautiful place named perhaps for the beech trees on a small river, the Stripa, but at the same time, it's a borderland. Let's begin with the beginning of the 17th century. The borderland includes Poland, and there's a castle on a hill. Whose castle is that, and what does it mean about the city of Buchach? Good evening to you.
Well, first of all, thank you very much for having me. Good evening. Yes, so Buchach is a little town in what is now Western Ukraine. And in that town, you can still find today the remnants of a castle that was built originally in the 14th century, but in the 16th century was reinforced, built as a stone castle. And in the 17th century, it was besieged several times, both by the Cossacks during the Cossack uprising of the middle of the 17th century, and by the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire, in the latter part in the 1670s, and was eventually captured by the Ottomans.
The castle is one part of the geography of the town. It's on a rise, a hill, it's called, looking over the Stripa River. The town of Buchach is below the castle, looking east.
If you stand on the castle looking at the town, you're looking east.
East. And the at the center of the town is the Great Synagogue and the Town Hall. Great Synagogue is no longer there, the Town Hall is. And then beyond the Great Synagogue is the Jewish Cemetery.
Yes, north of the Great Synagogue. So if you're standing on the castle, you look east, you're looking at the town. You look northeast and you're looking at another hill. It was called the Bashti Hill, which was also meant the hill of the towers, because it was part of the original fortifications of the town. And that's where the Jewish cemetery still is.
And then across the Stripa is another hill, a larger hill, Fedor Hill.
The Fedor Hill. So if you're standing on the castle and looking at the Fedor Hill, then you're looking east, southeast.
Why we're describing this geography is that the language of the Holocaust involves these three points. You can watch this story through the centuries. Sometimes, Professor, I felt like I was in H.G. Wells's story of the time machine, where the time machine doesn't move, but all around it is the spinning of centuries of conflict, the first war and then into the future and then backwards. But the time machine stays in one place. So your book is like a time machine, watching these three hills rise and fall, rise and fall. The period of time that where the horror is, and we'll come to it, is the German invasion of this area, Galicia, in 1939, and the Soviet invasion in 1939. The Soviets and the Germans cut up Poland. But we're going to start back in the 17th century for who lived there. The Poles had an empire. The Russians had an empire. The Austria-Hungarians, the Germans had an empire. In the 17th century, it was chiefly the Polish Empire. We're at the borderland. Who were the opponents? Who were the feuding groups of Buchach in the 17th century?
So in the 17th century, the what was called then the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth has expanded. It includes Poland, what is now Poland, what is now Belarus, what is now Lithuania, and what is now Western Ukraine, going all the way to Kiev and beyond, so really much of Ukraine itself. So it's a vast empire. It's actually the biggest in Europe, although most historians forget about it. And during that time, there is an uprising by the Cossacks who are serving as mercenaries of the Polish Empire. And those mercenaries feel that they're not getting their due, and they work together with peasants, serfs, who later will be called Ukrainians, to fight against that empire. And during that uprising, under a famous leader, Bohdan Khmelnytsky, they massacre tens of thousands of Jews, as well as many, many Poles. And Buchach comes under siege by them in 1648, during that siege. This is one focus of violence. The other is the Ottoman Empire. And the Ottoman Empire comes from the south and begins entering into Europe. We forget that the Ottoman Empire, much of it was actually in Europe. It was not in the Middle East. We think of it as a Middle Eastern empire. And in one of those battles, the Ottoman Empire actually captures Buchach and signs a peace with Poland, which leaves Buchach right on the border between the Polish kingdom and the Ottoman Empire.
This is one example of how Buchach goes back and forth between the competitors, although their names change. Buchach is always at the center, right. The Jews. Why the Jews are important here to the success of Buchach and then to the horror of Buchach is that Galicia is where the Jews mostly settle in the Polish Empire. I think at one point you said two-thirds of the Jews later on are in the Polish Empire. There's hundreds of thousands of Jews between Lithuania and Galicia, and this is where they emigrated to out of Europe. They came here out of Europe, is that why, or they were just prosperous here?
So from the 13th, 14th centuries, Jews living in Central Europe, in what we know now as Germany, and what the Jews called Ashkenaz, are being invited by Polish rulers to move to Poland because they're known as people who would develop commerce, who would develop trades, who would help build cities. And the Polish kings want to create their own commercial networks, their own cities, as exist already in Central and Western Europe. So they invite Jews there and they give them privileges. That is, they allow them to have monopolies over the creation of alcohol, over leasing estates. As the Polish kingdom expands to the east, Polish lords invite Jews to move to the east. And so by the 18th century, 80% of the population of Jews in the world live within the Polish kingdom. That is central Poland and increasingly these eastern parts of Poland, which we now know as Ukraine.
And that was called Galicia at the time.
Part of it is Galicia, right. And the area that I'm talking about is eastern Galicia, which is an area in which Poles were for a long time settlers, but were always a minority vis-a-vis the people who came to be known as Ukrainians or Ruthenians at the time.
Right, we're now in the 18th century, and the Jews are well established. The empires, however, are in competition. The empires' names have changed. We now have the Habsburg Empire, and we have the Russian Empire, and that competition is pressing on the Poles. And in the 18th century, the Austrians show up. I feel like we're always going to be invaded. It's just a matter of time. Remember that joke from Fiddler on the Roof? Why do you always wear your hat? Because we have to be ready to go. Yes, that's what it feels like in Buchach. Who's showing up now? I felt like I hear horses. Who is it? Okay. So in the 18th century, middle of the 18th century, about the time America is getting organized and in competition with the British, the Austrians show up. Now, are the Austrian, this is what eventually becomes the Austrian-Hungarian Empire, the night of the First World War, are they regarded as generous towards the Jews because they have a taxation, a special taxation on them, but at the same time, you report that they give them privileges.
Right. So we have to understand that in the latter part of the 18th century, Poland disappears. Mm. Poland is torn up. These are the three partitions of Poland. In the first partition, in 1772, this area that we know as Galicia is created. It's torn out of Poland, given the name Galicia, and becomes a province of the Habsburg Empire. And the Austrians who take it over want to make it into part of their empire. And they start organizing it according to their criteria. On the one hand, they have strong prejudices against the Jews, and they don't like the privileges the Jews had under Polish rule. On the other hand, they think that the Jews will help them Germanize that area, because the Jews speak Yiddish, and they see Yiddish as some kind of German language. And so their relationship to the Jews is complicated, but ultimately the position of Jews in the Austrian Empire begins to improve vis-a-vis the way it was under the Poles. So what you have is a reorganization of this entire territory under Austrian rule, which begins to identify different groups of peoples in a way that they were not identified before, as Poles, as Ruthenians, and as Jews, who are the population of Eastern Galicia, and who begin to think of themselves according to these categories being imposed on them by the Habsburg Empire.
We now have the three large players, Ruthenians, who become Ukrainians, Poles, and Jews in Buchach, and we plunge into the 19th century, because ahead of us is the horror of the Holocaust. But you have to understand who was in place in Buchach before the Germans invaded in the 20th century. The book is Anatomy of a Genocide, The Life and Death of a Town Called Buchach. Professor Omar Bartov is the author. I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show.